有请施浩德登台。Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Kirk Skaugen.
Good morning. Let me add my welcome to IDF Shenzhen. You know, I've been coming here now since 1999, and I'm making new friends and new colleagues that I know now will be with me for a lifetime. I just absolutely love seeing all the energy and innovation coming from China, and I can tell you, for the people that I talked to that were sick at home, that weren't able to make it here, they're very disappointed, because more and more, this event is becoming the place where innovation is being created and brought, not just to China, but around the world. So thank you for being here. I think this is the place to be. So as you saw in the video, the digital revolution is accelerating in China. It is the largest internet economy in the world, with more than 700 million smart devices in the hands of Chinese consumers and businesses. China is the number one connected device market in the world. It became number one in desktop PCs in 2007, number one in total PCs in 2011, and now the global leader in smartphones in 2012, and I don't think anyone thinks that's going to change anytime soon. This digital revolution has been led by consumers, but it's now shifting to enterprise, and that's creating even more momentum and opportunity for us. And connected clients are foundational to this revolution. As you heard Brian say yesterday, we had an outstanding 2014 together as partners in this developer community on both mobile and PC innovation. You know, when we set out to do 40 million tablets last year, I think we all thought it was an audacious goal. Hitting 46 million tablets, I think, had us all delighted. But what's very exciting is more than 40% of those came from here in Shenzhen in the China ecosystem. So thank you very much for that. We built a mobile turnkey solution that I'll talk more about that's really enabling us to scale across the world and make life easier for you to get platforms to market more quickly and with less work. We built and started growing the PC ecosystem even more here with new Core M and Core-based two-in-ones and portable all-in-ones from here in Shenzhen in China. And we launched the first new experiences with Intel RealSense in devices around the world. And you can just get a perspective here looking at this wall of systems from 4 inches to 5 inches to 6 inches all the way to 27 inches. All of this innovation came from Atom, Celeron, Pentium, Core, and Core M from here in China in 2014. So one more time, thank you very much. So in 2015, our goal is to expand that, and we fully plan to accelerate that growth in China. Today I want to talk about a few vectors that are going to enable us to do that. The first is cost reduction. We know this is becoming a more and more cost-focused market, and we have plans to enable that from PCs to tablets to phones and phablets. We're going to continue to segment our product lines, enabling you to sell up and build better value for your end customers. We're going to deliver an amazing amount of form factor innovation, probably more than we even had over the last several years. And we're going to talk about these new user experiences to eliminate wires, eliminate all passwords, and build new user interfaces with both voice and with gesture as we communicate with our devices. And our strategy, as BK said yesterday, is if it computes and connects, we want it to run best on Intel and be easiest to implement for you as developers on Intel. So let's start with mobile. Our strategy is to enable all form factors for mobile, from 4-inch to 5-inch to 6-inch tablets, 7, 8, and 10-inch tablets. We want to deliver solutions that can scale across that and be highly flexible for you to eliminate or to simplify your designs. We're going to build segmented branding. At Mobile World Congress, we announced new segments for the Atom processor, the X3, the X5, and the X7. And today I'll talk about how we're going to expand that and help you with go-to-market to enable that. We've got great new partnerships with Rockchip and Spreadtrum that are going to help us build more proliferations to address more markets and more price points. And we're going to put experiences on this that enable entry all the way to performance on Intel architecture. So, let's get started. At Mobile World Congress, we announced the Atom X3, which had been codenamed Sophia. And this is our new cost-competitive 64-bit Atom SoC with integrated Intel Wireless for the first time, where the application processor and the wireless are on the same chip. We have 2G and 3G solutions today, and we're excited that LTE is on track for the second half of 2015. This is the perfect part for the value and entry markets. And again, it's a single platform for phones, phablets, and tablets to help build that scale for you. We're delivering this on Android today and Windows 10 mobile in the future. And we're gonna talk a lot about this turnkey program we have to deliver reference designs, again, to make it easier to go to market even faster with Intel solutions. There are three competitive platforms on the Atom X3, and we're very excited on not just the bill of materials costs that we can now deliver competitive with ARM, but also the performance we're seeing with the competition. So the 3G dual core versus dual core competition, 60% faster than dual core competition. The 3GR collaboration with Rockchip is delivering a product that's almost twice as fast as our quad core competition, and the LTE will be more than twice the performance. So today we have now over 14 ODMs delivering more than 48 designs based on our master reference designs, with more to come. You know, just this week, last week, Weibo announced a 4-inch smartphone and a 7-inch tablet. Later today, Waterworld, I'll be participating in their press event. They're going to announce several new phone designs on the X3 platform as well. And yesterday, you heard Rockchip announcing 10 ODMs bringing this. So we feel very excited about the momentum that's coming here on the Atom X3 platform. I just wanted to show you a little of the progress that's been made. These platforms are now ready. So you see 5-inch on the top shelf, you see 5-inch, 6-inch, and 7-inch reference designs from Intel. We'll have reference designs scaling from 4 to 8 inches on the Atom X3 platform. These next two shelves are actually derivatives that have been built here in China based on those reference designs on the X3. So already a whole host from these 14 ODMs bringing those to market. On the next shelf, these are actually reference designs from Rockchip that are using the Atom X3. You can see they're using larger screen sizes from 8 to 10 inch and above to bring the Atom X3 into the tablet space to accelerate the proliferation here in Shenzhen. And then on the bottom, these are a number of 10 inch Bay Trail and Bay Trail cost reduced designs that are already in production based on the work together in 2014 and the first part of 2015. So tremendous progress. And these master reference designs we'll talk about are ready to go for you here in Shenzhen. Okay, let me talk about this turnkey program that we ramped in 2014 because it's very critical. First and foremost, we're putting senior leadership here in China because we're serious about this being one of the key development centers for the world. And WK Tan is our vice president and general manager here, responsible for the turnkey program. And it enables you to build, basically using a full master reference design at the board or the system level. We're now seeing customers get to market just 6 to 8 weeks after they receive this reference design. And this used to take multiple quarters on Intel. We're down to 6 to 8 weeks. We have 30 ODMs that built 350 designs last year that shipped into 50 countries based on these reference designs. And we're now able to use that and scale using the Intel brand and our channel to get you more customers as you use these master reference designs. And what's more exciting is these master reference designs are enabling higher quality. So our customers are now back reporting 20% fewer returned materials when they use our reference designs versus the competition. A 20% lower return rate based on the higher quality they're seeing from the master reference designs. And you can see just a number of the X3 partners, but I'm excited that we're gonna expand this program beyond mobile devices into two-in-ones with Core M this year, and also onto our X5 platform that I'll talk about in a few minutes. Rather than have me talk about it, I'd like to show you a video of what some of our customers here in China are saying about this new turnkey program. If you could roll the video, please.
I think the most successful which we thought is to really speed up the design cycle. It makes the product more competitive, which we never saw that 3 years ago.
the MRT is much easier for ODMs to take the design from Intel and use very small number of resources to develop into a product.
We call that cookie cutting business. For a smaller company, ODM, they basically can take the MRD and do cookie cutting. We can easily manufacture and develop product based on that.
有这些一些物料，英特尔在选取时也考虑了它的可获取性。对我们来讲，就是当后期在我们的大量生产的时候，是会很有帮助的。
Intel reference design in terms of Android software stability is actually one of the best in the industry in terms of the speed, performance, as well as the robustness.
Intel 平板的品质，我认为在所有的目前来讲，平板的品质里面排在最前面。整个的这个 Intel 返修率其实相当低。相比于其他的芯片供应商， Intel 是在这方面做得最为出色的一家。目前统计的数据，它的整个的 IMU 的比率可能只有以往我们 ARM based 产品的不到一半。
I'm very impressed with the dramatic changes that Intel has made in such a short time to support our new product. A year ago, we couldn't do business together, but now.I believe we will have a long-lasting partnership.
Look at the technical support from feedback from our R&D software. We have a handy response. We have a tool ready to evaluate all the key components.
我认为，不论是在技术，还是在市场，还是在销售，我们得到了超乎预期的这种支持和服务。
I think it's amazing with your feedback how far we've come in such a short amount of time. And I'm happy to have with us today the president of Bluebank, a leading smartphone and tablet ODM here in China, Mr. He Tao. Can you please introduce yourself? Well, we saw you in the video. Thank you for being here. Can you share us a little bit about why you're excited about the Atom X3 and Sophia and a little bit about Bluebank?
Okay, thank you for having me here.南大通讯呢，实际上是一家长期做手机的企业，然后我们多年来都用那个为世界上的顶级品牌做过这个手机发货到美国或者欧洲很多地方，然后3年多前我们都用英特尔的第一代的那个移动通讯的平台，加上外挂的 TD 的 modem 和 WCDMA 的 modem 为中国市场做过手机。但是呢，这些平台呢，它因为是外挂的这个 modem， 所以说的成本比较高，发货量不是太大，所以说2014年呢，我们整个的在一直在做平板电脑。那现在呢，索菲亚的出现呢，让我们非常的高兴，因为索菲亚是 Intel 的第一个这种单芯片的平台，然后我们用它呢，可以做从4寸的手机到8寸的通话平板，整个全系列的产品。所以说呢，这个而且我们不用它的 modem 是全世界的证明过的，我们不用太担心在世界各地的certification 和这种 interoperability， 就是跟各个运营商的不同网络的兼容性。所以说呢，我们认为 Intel 有了这个索菲亚的这个平台呢，能够肯定能够改变整个移动通讯的这个产业界的这个状况。所以说我们南岸通讯呢非常高兴。有这个机会和英特尔一起来推动和实现这种改变。
So how about the turnkey program? You saw the video, but maybe we can talk a little bit about the turnkey program.
Right. 这个 turnkey， 我们这一年多一直在用Bayswell CR 和 Sophia 的这个 turnkey MRD 来开发这个我们的平板和手机。那这个相对于其他的芯片供应商来说，英特尔的这个Turnkey Program 这个 MRD 呢，它从稳定性和成熟性来说都非常的好，而且也充分考虑了中国市场这个元器件的选择，基本上你拿到这个 Turnkey 呢，就直接可以量产，而且 Intel 的这个服务呢，就是对客户的支持也非常的好，这大大的缩减了深圳我们 IDF 和这个 System Integrator 这个上市的时间和用的人力，实际上这直接贡献了就是 Intel 去年。能够达到4600万出货量，平板出货量，这是一个很大的原因。如果说我们有任何要抱怨，有一个事情要抱怨 Intel 的事，就是Intel 这个 Turnkey Solution 的大大的降低了这个 准入的门槛，让这个设计特别的容易。所以说对我们南站这样的比较偏重技术的公司来说呢，我们反而丢失了一个在产业界的这个产业链的一个价值。
So maybe we can show them a couple of your beautiful designs.
Okay. So, 我们刚才说这个 Intel 的这个设计呢，它实际上价格已经非常低了，用那个 X3。所以这是我手上有个4.5寸的手机，这个手机呢能够做到4.5寸的 FWB 接，可以做到40块钱以下。4寸其实可以做到接近30块钱出头。然后这个5寸的这个手机呢，Beautifully made， 然后这个只要大概50多块钱，5寸的这个金属框架的手机，然后还有这个7寸的通话平板，7寸的通话平板只有8毫米厚，然后这个大概在60以下，55左右。这个7寸的通话平板，所以说英特尔的产品已经完全可以跟所有的芯片的价格来比拼了。
Okay, well, thank you very much for your partnership.
Thank you.
I think everyone agrees we saw here 3 Intel Atatech 3 phones. So thank you. Remember, everyone carries 3 phones. That's the action item out of the room. So we're not stopping at X3. We're also building our first Intel Atom processors, the X5 and X7, on our 14-nanometer process, codenamed Cherry Trail. These are doubling the 3D performance and graphics performance while still offering great battery life. For mainstream to performance, we now have 25 designs, and the first design was actually announced last week, the Microsoft Surface 3. This is the thinnest, lightest Surface design from Microsoft that they've ever built, just 622 grams, fanless, and 8.7 millimeters thick. But not just Windows RT, a full Windows 8.1 experience, and that's just a start of what's going to happen with the X5 and X7 platforms. Today I'm announcing that we're going to expand the turnkey program for the Atom X5 on Windows starting in the third quarter of 2015. And you're going to start seeing new experiences like wireless docking, RealSense cameras, and wireless charging on the second wave of these devices, which we're extremely excited about. So X5 and X7 on track and ramping now in the marketplace. In wireless, we've been developing comms and connectivity solutions now for over 20 years, and we have a full set of solutions optimized for Intel architecture for smartphones, tablets, and PCs, whether they're integrated solutions on SoFIA, modules, or discrete. Last month at MWC, we launched a new leadership LTE modem solution, enabling speeds of up to 450 megabit per second and 3x carrier aggregation. And we now have solutions and new solutions for Wi-Fi, for Bluetooth, for FM radio, GNSS, and NFC, becoming a one-stop shop for communications and connectivity. Wirelessly is increasingly important, and what I thought I'd do is just show you one of these amazing new devices that was announced. This is the ASUS ZenFone 2. It started shipping in China just last week. It uses the Intel Moorfield processor and Intel's LTE TDDI, starting at just ₩1299 RMB. It's a fabulous phone, and it has a new Pixel Master 2 that's enabling incredible photos in any light condition. So this is just one example of the amazing phones that's coming out with Intel connectivity solutions. Congratulations to ASUS. I understand I met with Jerry, the CEO, yesterday. He's doing extremely well on the market since launch, and we're very excited for ASUS on that. Okay, I'm going to run now to PCs and talk about PC reinvention. And at the end of the day, the PC has become and has been an essential part of our lives. Foundational to education, to our entertainment experience, to our creative expression. Migrant workers here in China are using it to advance their education and improve their lives. And we really can't imagine business or our home lives without them. You know, for those of us that are on the road, video, WeChatting, or Skyping back home and to those that we love is something that keeps us connected and keeps us alive as we're on the road. So the impact on society is huge, and our job is to keep innovating the PC to keep it growing. You know, what was just a few years ago, a traditional clamshell and a tower is now expanded. Here's 16 different form factors that are available, from high-end gaming machines to ComputeStick's amazing choice in color and form factor versus what we just had 2 to 3 years ago. And this is a very special year because it's once in a decade where an amazing new platform like the 6th generation Core on Skylake is going to come with Windows 10. And I just want to talk to you about the China PC ecosystem. Today, over 140 million PCs in China are more than 4 years old. And if you take the existing products in the market today with 5th generation Core, we're seeing twice as long a battery life, half the weight, half the thickness, 12 times better graphics, almost 10 times faster wake up, and 8x faster video conversion. Even on basic office productivity, 150% improvement. This is an amazing opportunity. And as China sells to the rest of the world, 600 million PCs now are over 4 years old. This is an amazing year for us with Windows 10 launching and these kind of statistics relative to this aging installed base. So, I also want to talk about Core M, because this was a new brand that we built exclusively for mobility. The best of a PC and the best of a tablet in a two-in-one. And this is one of the fastest growing segments we have in computing. Amazing new designs from Asus, Lenovo, Acer, and Cube, and I just thought I'd show you why this is going to be such an amazing year. This is a traditional four-year-old PC, four-year-old notebook, believe it or not. You see the DVD drive, the old video connector. It's almost hard for me, honestly, to hold it out here. You compare it against a new Asus T300 Qi, and it's absolutely just stunning, the progress relative to a four-year-old PC. Take this from me, please. If you look at the Asus Qi, this is just 720 grams, just stunningly thin, more than twice the performance of an iPad Air, $699. And when you detach it, 720 gram tablet, 7.6 millimeters thick. And again, twice the performance of an iPad Air in tablet mode. This Lenovo Yoga 3 Pro has 9 hours of battery life, 3200 by 1800 resolution. It is just absolutely stunning when you look at the thickness of this and the kind of performance you can get. And of course, with 9 hours of battery life, you can flick it over and get a full PC experience. So, stunning design from Lenovo. And again, I think it's incredibly impressive with the new watch band hinge, the kind of design that they've done on this thing. There's over 70 now entry-level two-in-ones coming out of the China technology ecosystem, 20 of them based on Core M. And Craig's just showing you two here from Cube with an i7 display here, full HD display, Core i7. And from Ramos, a new product is coming this month. So we're starting to bring Core M tablets and two-in-ones to the marketplace that shipped over 40% of our tablets last year, now ramping up on Core M two-in-ones and tablets as well. So thank you guys for that. We aren't stopping there in the desktop. All-in-ones and portable all-in-ones are great examples of PC reinvention. You see the 27-inch and the smaller screen size design from Lenovo here. What's exciting, as you can see in the picture, is we're now laying a lay-flat experience where you can have people on both sides of the PC interacting. More than 170 applications now available for multi-user, multi-touch, where people can gather around the PC and play Mahjong. One example here in China is we work with DragonSoft to enable applications like Droughts and Woozy to come to the PC. So this is a new usage model, lay flat, where you can carry that all-in-one around with a battery in the back of it, around the house, lay it on the counter, and interact with it around as a family. We're not stopping there on the desktop. One of the most exciting areas now is the miniaturization of compute. And what I wanted to show you here is this is something that's being used in business, large enterprise, and Internet of Things. This is a Weibo design. This is one of the world's smallest motherboards that actually takes a standard socketed CPU. If you see this, this is actually a 35-watt CPU on this motherboard, LGA motherboard. And you can put it now in these amazing new designs. So imagine a full 35-watt desktop behind a smart sign, a point-of-sale terminal, or a kiosk, or just a standard enterprise PC. Amazing innovation by Weibo. But as you may have read in the press, we're going to take that even further, and we're now moving to a new product called the Intel Compute Stick. And this is now a product that we're launching into the marketplace. It's an Intel quad-core Atom, a Baytrail TCR, and it's incredibly thin. It's with Windows 8.1 Bing or Ubuntu Linux preloaded with 1 or 2 gig of memory and up to 32 gigabytes of storage and Wi-Fi, all in this small device. It literally plugs into your HDMI port in the back of your monitor or TV and makes any product a smart quad-core Intel architecture-based experience. And we're going to bring all the design collateral for this to you here in Shenzhen so you can begin building these on Intel architecture, whether you want them on Windows, Bing, or on Ubuntu Linux, starting just in the next few days and upcoming weeks. Next is graphics. And graphics are essential to the computing experience. As you can see from the chart here, we're over 100 times the graphics performance with fifth generation Core over the last 9 years. And Iris Pro, the logos here now, are gaining momentum and can now outperform 80% of the volume of discrete cards in the market today. 80% of volume discrete cards can be outperformed with Intel integrated graphics and media. Significant bill of material savings, significant power savings, significant cost savings. And today I'm thrilled to announce that Lenovo will begin shipping Iris graphics on their G Series mainstream notebooks this summer across their entire G Series line. So thank you, Lenovo. The action for you is to design an Iris graphics to deliver better performance, power, and lower cost and bill of materials. Gaming. Where best to talk about gaming than China? And graphics and media are great for all users, but especially for gamers. Now there's over 1 billion gamers in the world, PC gamers, and 245 million of those are here in China. And gamers love the PC. They love to customize it. They love its scalability and its openness. And so here for China, we've delivered the first 8-core, 16-thread machine at 3.5 gigahertz, and the first 4-core, 4 gigahertz we call Devil's Canyon. I think I'd like to show you a little bit of what these systems can do, because these are the world's fastest PCs now enabled on some of the gaming. So Craig, why don't you show them what we have here?
Yeah, let me show you this incredible, as far as the pinnacle of your gaming for extremers experience, this is what we want. This tower right here houses our 8-core, 16 threads, 40 lanes of PCIe, and what does that translate to? Well, a wonderful experience like this. I know you guys are very familiar with 4K gaming. We decided to triple it up. With the muscle that we have under this hood, we're able to do 12K gaming with 3 4K monitors across the board. That's over 24 million pixels that we're pushing at 60 times per second. So, what does that look like? Looks like a great experience like this. All right. We'll go ahead and turn it up. A lot of explosions and other goodies. But this is definitely, when we take a look around at all the detail, this is the type of experience we want to see. And you guys are, please go down and look at the booth or take a look at these screens here. It's even a higher resolution that we can represent on our big screens here. But
yeah, we're seeing a lot of people now wanting to go to mobile as well. We just talked about Iris being able to outperform 80% of the discrete card volume. So let's look at what you can do on even a mobile platform with Intel Iris Pro.
Yeah, any discerning gamer knows it's not all about the great experience. And what we're showing here is an HP system, and we're running one of the most anticipated upcoming games in China, which is Moon Knight Princess here. And we're able to run it on our Iris Pro system. This is a brand new 15-inch HP Envy with Iris Pro graphics to give us that great mobile experience, even on the run.
Awesome, and they're displaying it here in great resolution as well.
Absolutely, go all the way up to 4K with this type of solution.
Thank you. Well, you're going to see these amazing systems in action because Intel's been sponsoring Intel Extreme Masters, which is a global gaming competition, and we're committed to bringing it back here into China in the future as well. So look for an Intel Extreme Masters event. We're literally filling stadiums with 20 or 30,000 people to watch the best PC gamers compete head-to-head. Okay, on the other end of the spectrum, the value space. And whether it was Chrome or Linux or Windows, you guys did an amazing job delivering value-oriented Chrome and Windows systems down even below $199 last year. And we are now, I'm announcing today, shipping Braswell, the follow-on to Bay Trail M and D, which is our latest 14 nanometer processor for value and entry PCs. Even thinner, sleeker designs with lower power, but twice the battery life, twice the graphics rather, and battery life improvements of almost over 10% versus our traditional Bay Trail platforms. Again, validated on Windows, Chrome, and Linux, and we're seeing now over 40 designs today from essential PCs to all-in-ones. The star of the show this year will be Skylake and our sixth generation core, and today I'm proud to reconfirm it's on track for the second half of this year. We're gonna make significant performance improvements with sixth generation core in both performance and battery life. We'll offer DDR4 for mainstream systems. And you saw Brian yesterday show you some of the systems. I thought I'd just share with you a few of the reference designs in more detail here. So this is a reference design, a 2-in-1 detachable, 8 millimeters display. If you actually detach, you get a full 4K display, USB-C connectors. We're actually running USB-C, I think, over the connector here as well. Actually, a 4K display and an integrated world-facing 3D camera. So we're starting to see a real sense integrated into these tablets. But I can assure you I don't have fat fingers. I'm just amazingly thin at under 8 millimeters here on that design. We're also going to have some amazing all-in-ones. And this is our reference design for a portable all-in-one, a 4K display here. But I just want to show you just how amazingly thin a desktop PC is going to get with a full core, sixth generation core experience and 4K display, under 10 millimeters thin. If I lay it flat here, you can see it almost disappears on the table, and this is why you can have that across the table gaming experience. It's just incredibly thin. And let me just kind of show you how thin it is. And I know you guys like big phones in China, so if you want to buy a phone, we can sell it to you as a phone, no problem, okay? All right. For software developers, we also are building the world's first no-wires PC. This actually has an integrated e-ink display on the back that you can customize, but this is going to be the world's first PC where you would never need to connect a wire to it. Not for docking to the display, not for charging because it has integrated charging in the base, not for display because it has integrated WiDi. So this is the ultimate software development platform, and you can just talk to our team and get a full system that will actually have no passwords and no wires required on the world's first sixth generation core machine. So please, if you're a software developer, look at that from our developer relations group. Okay, lastly, I wanted to talk about a whole set of new user experiences that we're bringing. And whether you're talking about wearables, phones, tablets, phablets, or PCs, our goal is to eliminate all wires for computing, eliminate all passwords for computing, and bring new gesture and voice to these devices. We do over 250,000 interviews a year, and these are the three pain points that are consistently coming up from end users. So let's start with this no wires experience. And you know, I don't know about you, but when I come to China, this is kind of what I carry in my bag. If I had you all hold this above your head, I think we'd have a mountain of cables here, whether they're display cables or power bricks or USB chargers for a phone. Our job is to get rid of all of this stuff. And we're working with the resin standard. It's a standard around magnetic resonance technology around A4WP. We're gonna have all of the largest airports and coffee shops and train stations enabled with wireless charging. And in fact, yesterday across the street, I visited the first coffee shop where we put wireless charging into all the tables of the coffee shop. You can literally walk in, drop your phone down, and see the charging there. On wireless data, yesterday you saw Doug Fisher, who was talking about Open Interconnect Consortium and the standards work we're doing for device-to-device transfer. And we're enabling WiGig for wireless docking. We'll show you that in a second, along with our Intel wireless display technology. I guess what I should do, though, is just show you a demonstration of what it's like to have a no-wires office. So, Craig, why don't we show them what we have here?
Well, this is our complete vision of the no-wires office. Here I have my 2-in-1 PC. I will go ahead and down to my desk. I throw it down, and all of my, all of my displays are connected, all of my storage, all of my peripherals, all of the cords are really way down across our desk and in our backpacks. But as you can see, in addition, we're also wirelessly charging as well. So as far as in the desk of the future, I go ahead and put it down and I can just automatically be able to charge immediately when I get that brand, when I get that brand new wireless solution.
So this is the Y-Gang dock here.
Yep.
And all your peripherals and I.O. are there, and it's charging from below the table.
That's exactly right. So we installed it below, and I can just illustrate this with a LED board here that we have that works specifically with our magnetic resonance. And as I put it down there, you can see I've recreated this nice wireless hotspot that I have here. And what can I do with it? Well, I go ahead and have a phone. It's going to go ahead and charge there. I can go ahead and add multiple devices. So I have a my Bluetooth earpiece or all my other wearables, and that's instantly charging. But we do realize as Intel, there are multiple solutions and multiple standards out there for wireless charging. So what we want to provide is a way to get over that hurdle so that we can always have the user having the best experience. You don't want to go into a coffee shop and throw down your phone and realize that you have the wrong version of wireless charging. So what we're able to do is go ahead and I take this phone, we can actually run it in tri-mode. So not only working with Intel magnetic resonance, but also I have a Qi charger here, so I can go ahead and put this guy down. And he's gonna go ahead and charge up for me. I know you will. There we go. Okay, charging with Qi. Also, with our A4WP partner, with PowerMat, I'm able to go ahead and put it down, and just like that, we're charging up as well. So I'm able to go ahead and across the ecosystems, be able to get the same experience that I do over here with all the advantages. The spatial freedom that I get around, the multiple devices, and all the way up to multiple power profiles, so we can charge our largest two-in-one and all-in-one devices here.
That's awesome. Good stuff. So wireless charging momentum is building in China. Haier is bringing wireless charging solutions to market. Xiaomi is adopting Intel wireless display for their TVs and over-the-top boxes. iQIYI is integrating WiDi in their stream video application to extend the experience. And Lenovo is committed to cutting the cords for their corporate customers. Let's take a look at what Lenovo thinks about no wires.
I can't wait for a world of no wires. Imagine going to a meeting with a customer, and you have a 30-minute meeting, and you're spending 5 or 10 minutes juggling cables. This is a huge impact on productivity, not being able to communicate your ideas to the customer. Our newest ThinkPads that have the Intel 5th generation core are enabled for Pro Wi-Fi solutions that solve this pain point. If you walk around the office spaces of any enterprise company, you'll see a cluttered desk of cables, conference room full of cables. So we're working very closely with Intel on the Y-Gig solutions, making sure that there are no cables, or eliminating as many cables as possible. So imagine an office worker coming into work and coming to his desk and not having any wires, being able to use their notebook and be immediately be productive using its large screen monitor. Imagine them going into a conference room and immediately turning off their systems and presenting their ideas to their customers or an inter-office meeting. I can't wait to see the office of the future. That's the vision that we have, and we're working very closely with Intel to go address those pain points.
In the space and some of the amazing solutions they have. No passwords. So one of the craziest things out there is trying to remember the average 18 passwords we all have that want to change on us every 90 days or so. Yesterday you saw Brian showing a Windows 10 facial login solution using the Intel RealSense camera. But there are other options that we want to show you today as well through companies that we've invested in that innovation fund we talked about yesterday. And one of those is iris scanning for authentication. I'd like to show you what we've done with our partner iSmart on iris scanning recognition technology. And joining me on stage is Mr. Leo Wang, the CEO of iSmart. So hi.
Hi, Terry.
So, yeah, why don't you tell them what we can do with iris scanning?
Yeah, brilliant. Thanks for the opportunity, Kirk. iSmart provides a new iris payment experience, which is faster, safer, and 然后我们提供虹膜识别技术的自主知识产权全天解决方案和 和更加便利安全的虹膜支付应用体验。So, Kirk, it's a great pleasure to work with your team in China. They are committed to bring the new neural experience model to consumers. This is their Intel Core processor 2-in-1, enabled with iSmart Iris recognition technology ready, and also protected by Intel security technologies. So, thanks for this technology. I can now log into my bank account just using my Iris. So I'm going to give you a quick go. And that's it. No more password, just click.
So that's a PC, that's what we do on a phone.
Exactly. So this is an IA phone.
Lenovo K80
phone. Lenovo K80 phone, yeah. And then also has Iris IOM, Iris Home Mobile Technology Building. So iSmart is working with Lenovo to bring this smartphone to market soon. And also we are working with China Mixon Bank for mobile banking payment on Iris. So imagine you are you're buying a product offline at the shop, and then with this technology, you can just to scan the barcode, and you get the product information from offline to online, select the credit card or debit card number you want to use, and then confirm the payment with your eye. That's it.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Thank you. So again, shopping on Tencent with 2-in-1s, a Lenovo Intel-based K80 phone with China UnionPay and iSmart. Great stuff. Thank you very much. We're also transforming the way we interact with PCs away from keyboards and mice with natural user interfaces we would never have imagined 5 years ago. Let me show you some of the videos of some typical reactions we get from people who are using RealSense technology. Run the video, please. All right. The best thing you can do is just go down to the showcase and play for it yourself and look at the smiles on everyone's face. This is the kind of excitement we're getting to reinvigorate the PC, which you also saw yesterday coming down to the phablets as well. PCs with RealSense are now shipping from Asus, Dell, Fujitsu, HP, Lenovo, and NEC, and we're committing more than 65 applications by the end of the year on RealSense. So what I thought I'd do is have you take a look at what Tencent's doing with RealSense for users of the largest video conferencing platform in the world, QQ. So, Craig, take it away.
Yeah, so here we're on the Tencent QQ platform, and I've set up a call. And what's really cool, this is going to be an available technology later this year that we're going to be able to see that's usable by anyone with a RealSense laptop or compute device. So, here, which we're going to see the effect live, I have my buddy Cameron here, and it looks like he's just back in his cube in California. But he can literally be anywhere with this real-time green screen type technology. Oh, he's on a beach. Or he's on the mountains. Oh yeah, okay. Outer space. Something like that. There you go. Okay. All right. Okay. Back to the mountain, please. But as you see, this is the type of amazing experience you're going to be able to get. He doesn't have any sort of extra green screen or other equipment that he needs, just a 3D camera, and just a and just an experience on Tencent QQ. That's going to be cool.
New software development kit, I think one of the things we wanted to show the audience is what you could do in literally 1 or 2 days, taking the real Sense SDK and building an amazing app. So why don't we show what they were able to do here?
Yeah, so I'd like to introduce everyone to Archer Gong. Archer Gong works with TBS, which makes a ton of excellent RealSense development and entertainment solutions. And what Archer did was put together an application in 72 hours that we're going to show you here in a second. I myself was very impressed, and I think you guys will be as well. So Archer, go ahead and show the audience what we have here. So just by logging into our RealSense platform. Oh, here we go. Okay. And can we bring down the lights just a little bit more? There we go. Okay, now Archer's starting to get going. In the 72 hours, he's put this solution together and submitted it to our SDK program. And what he is actually doing is not only is he controlling his on-screen avatar with gesture, but we're actually looking at a real-time on-desktop robot that's able to go ahead and react to his commands. Not only gesture, but he can also use voice as well to control his platform.
That's amazing. So just in 3 days, he was able to use the SDK to integrate voice and RealSense gesture into this robot. That's amazing.
Pretty much. Thank you very much, Archer. That is amazing. Thanks. And then, you know, we got some extra candy here at the end. I know it's
one of your favorites. I want to see if even an Intel guy can do this, but this is something we're going to do with Face Shift to prepare an avatar. So I like it, but you can actually change your avatar, and you can actually do this with video conferencing. So,
please, Mike, tell
them. Or something like that, I think, fits Kirk a little bit more. What do we got there?
Yeah, so a lot of fun stuff. All right, thank you. So lastly, voice. We're working with iFlyTech to bring voice recognition to the PC, in addition to Cortana, which will be on Windows 10. iFlyTech just released version 3.0 of their software. You can see it downstairs in the showcase. A new personal assistant with a redesigned user interface, more personalized recommendations, and an enhanced dictation capability for 10 dialects of Mandarin available this year. So again, voice and personal assistants coming to the PC here in China with both Cortana on Windows 10 as well as with iFlyTech. So in conclusion, hopefully what I've showed you is there's an incredible amount of new product and new innovation, and a lot of that innovation is starting right here in Shenzhen, and that's why we're here. We want to deliver great new mobile experiences on the Atom X3 platform in Sofia, build new mainstream and premium tablets with the Atom X5 and X7 and the new master reference designs we'll have. We're excited to bring new Core M-based tablets and 2-in-1s growing up where you can make a little bit more margin and get into the PC space here. Bringing new value and entry solutions with Braswell to market. And again, a once-in-a-lifetime, or at least once-in-a-decade opportunity with Windows 10 and Skylake with an installed base of 140 million 4-year-old PCs in China. And then a whole set of new experiences around eliminating passwords, eliminating wires, and delivering new user experiences. So in summary, I want to thank you for an outstanding 2014, and I'm super excited to be here almost once a month for the next 3 months in China to help innovate with you. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Diane Bryant.
That was that good morning, so I'm sure you didn't recognize it, but my best attempt. So it is a very, very exciting time for the industry of information and communication technology. We are in the middle of a massive transformation of the industry, a transformation to the digital service economy, or the on-demand economy, as it's been coined. True on-demand is possible when the data center is software-defined. And there isn't a more exciting place to be during this massive transformation than here in China. In China, there are 780 million people online. Online sales in China is projected to grow another 32% in 2015. China continues to be the country with the fastest adoption of new devices this year, estimated to be almost a half a billion smartphones, which is 3 times the sales in the US and a third of the total units worldwide. And China is the country that accounts for the highest growth of the worldwide spend on information and communication technology. And that is reflected in the growth of the China local OEMs, each of them growing over 50% in 2014. So with this level of growth and investment, China will command a significant influence on the future of technology. And China is a great place to see the impact that technology can have on consumer behavior. One great example is Singles Day. Every year, the results of Singles Day is more astonishing than the prior year. $9.3 billion in sales, an increase of 63% year over year, 278 million transactions handled through online ordering and payment systems. To just stop and consider the scalability of the systems required, both hardware and software, to deliver that kind of one-day spike in demand is the perfect proof point for the value of cloud computing and of software-defined infrastructure, fundamentally required to support the demands of the digital service economy. And this is what's fueling the growth of the information and communication technology industry. ICT is increasingly the means to fulfill business, public sector, and consumer needs. And it's this virtuous cycle, billions of connected devices. With more connected devices, you draw in new services being deployed. Those services drive the build out of cloud computing. And this virtuous cycle continues. The pace of this cycle, the rate at which new services are being deployed and launched and existing services are growing, is tremendous. A second underlying driver of growth in ICT is Jevons paradox. Now, Jevon, in 1865, William Jevon declared that if you invest in a resource and make that resource more and more efficient, rather than the demand for that resource declining, the demand for the resource actually increases. As you make the resource more efficient, there are new usages for that resource that emerge. And certainly that's what we see in technology. Technology is becoming ever more efficient thanks to Moore's Law and thanks to the continuous innovation of the industry. The result is that there are 3 significant growth drivers in technology for the data center. Continued build-out of cloud computing, big data analytics, and high-performance computing. And I'll talk about each of them briefly. So let's start with the opportunity in cloud computing. Data traffic continues to grow, as you know. It's projected to quadruple between 2013 and 2018, hitting 6.5 zettabytes in 2018. Today, 55% of all applications and services are delivered through a cloud architecture. Whether it's public cloud or on-premise private cloud, whether it's software as a service like services from Alibaba, or whether it's infrastructure as a service like services from China Mobile or China Telecom, 55%, that's a big number. And it's just really been a couple of years that cloud computing has gone from novel to now truly mainstream. And what's made cloud computing so attractive is that it is a clear and compelling value proposition. Like every generation of computing architecture over the history, the solution becomes more efficient and lower cost. It attracts and is accessible by more and more people, and the applications that are delivered become broader and wider. Cloud computing, as the next generation of computer architecture, is compelling for the data center manager, it's compelling for the application developer, and it's compelling for the consumer. For the application developer, they're going to get their new service to market, new, faster time to revenue, much quicker with cloud computing. If you're IT, you're going to get lower operational costs due to the automation of a data center, and you're going to get lower capital costs because you're running your infrastructure at higher and higher levels of utilization. And if you're the consumer, cloud computing is great because you have instant access to any service. There's no downtime, there's no capacity limitations, there's no constraints. And so that abstraction of cloud computing, the abstraction of the software to the hardware, is clearly beneficial. It just makes things easy. So let's see how it works.
当今世界正在转向云计算，为了支撑这一转型，数据中心需要依靠软件定义架构 SDI 这样新一代的优化技术来重新构建数据中心。在这样现代化的数据中心，您可以定义应用和运营策略，而由协同软件来自动的调度及配置资源来满足您的需求。这就是基于 SDI 现代化数据中心的不同之处。它们更智能，自我感知，自我优化，自主伸缩，自我愈合。自动及智能意味着部署时间从原来的数周缩短为几分钟，投资成本降低的同时，运营效率却大幅提升，并且您已经升级的数据中心可以支撑下一代创新服务以及新的业务增长的机会。那么自动协同是如何工作的呢？这源于协同层不断的观察遍布数据中心各种资源内的探头，从而监控它们目前的运行状况。一旦服务需求改变，协同层会智能地分析该服务请求，从而实时地决定最佳的资源支持。然后协同层会自动地行动来调整资源，并符合管理策略的要求。之后协同层软件会通过自我学习能力，基于过去的决策来改进将来的决策，将数据中心变成可自我分析的大脑。
So SDI, Software Defined Infrastructure, is infrastructure that watches the environment. It independently decides when more capacity or capability is needed by a given service.And then it automatically takes action to deploy the right server, storage, and network to that application. And through machine learning algorithms and big data analytics, the infrastructure learns and becomes smarter in predicting the needs of the application. So software-defined infrastructure creates a future where the application is actually defining the system. And we've created an architecture, a reference architecture, that's purpose-built for software-defined infrastructure. It's the next generation of today's rack-based infrastructure. We call it rack-scale architecture. And of course, it is a common Intel architecture across servers, storage, and networking. It's defined to meet the needs of the cloud service providers, as well as enterprise, as well as the telco community.And the objective of the rack scale architecture reference design is to deliver greater efficiency. You get 1.5 times the compute density per rack through the elimination of redundant components. You get 2.5 times the network capacity through distributed local switching. And you get a 5x reduction in the power provision through right-sizing of the power distribution to the system versus having to over-provision for capacity that then is never used. And there's no better one to talk about the creation of highly efficient hyperscale data centers than Alibaba. Alibaba operates leading online and mobile marketplaces. They have hundreds of thousands of servers in production.And they're a leading innovator in the data center. So I'm very happy to have with me today Mr. Song Liu, the Alion GM, who's responsible for ecosystems and business development. And he'll talk to you about Alibaba's innovations and innovations with Intel. Thank you. Thank
you for that. 好，非常荣幸参加 IDF 15，接受 Intel 的邀请。我大概三分钟说三件事情跟大家分享一下。第一个是阿里云的现状，第二个是阿里巴巴和 Intel 在数据中心方面的技术合作，第三点分享一下我们对于未来云生态的一个看法。那么阿里巴巴可能是一个家喻户晓的电商公司，同时我们也有金融的业务。那阿里云呢，今年已经进入第六年，我们认为呢进入到了第二个很大的一个十年，这时候我们会有很多的创新。在阿里云起始于服务于阿里巴巴自己的一些业务，但过去这4-5年来，阿里已经有了在中国包括现在在海外 超过100万的客户，然后我们今年的1月份，并且在硅谷啊启动了我们海外的第一个数据中心，并且我们今年还会在欧洲、中东啊、新加坡都会有新的一个 data center。那么在长期以来 ，Intel 一直都是阿里一个非常大的合作伙伴，并且呢，随着我们云计算业务的每年 double 的这个速度，我们对于数据中心的要求就带来了一个更高的一个要求。那么在阿里与 Intel 在共同探索下一代的数据中心，因为要管理未来可能数百万台这种 server 的情况下，可能用原有的模式已经是不可以的了。所以我们跟阿里跟 Intel 的技术人员在 SDI Software Defined Infrastructure RSA Rack Scale Architecture 做了一些探索，并且我们去年年底共同点亮了全球第一个这个 RSA 的机架在阿里的实验室。那么带来的好处呢，是第一，帮助我们在规划下一代的可能几百万台的数据中心的这个架构方面呢，通过供应链的这个灵活性，能够降低我们的成本。第二点呢，我们通过把大规模的，今天我们云计算的数据中心未来是应该是以 rack 为单位的，那无论里面的 CPU、cache 内存啊，包括我们都是采用这种pooling 啊这种池化的方式，这会带来我们单位计算成本的巨大的一个提升。那我相信最终这个会对我们整个推动未来的互联网及云生态会带来一个非常大的一个 benefits 啊，所以所有的客户和企业都会因此而受益。那最后我稍微分享一下，就是我们的 belief， 就是我们认为云计算未来是一个用生态来构建的一个大的一个覆盖全社会的一种存在感。那么20年来 Intel Inside 的这个一个 slogan 啊，其实深入人心，我们中国人可能20年前开始用 PC 就已经很知道了。其实这种生态的观念也是阿里巴巴现在想追求的啊。我们现在有很大的一个公有云的服务，我们认为我们只是下边很小的一块，我们更大的是去 enable 上面的云生态，进而在未来的10年帮助中国的企业和政府在我们现在流行的词汇叫互联网加，在下一个方面呢创造出更多的社会化的企业，帮助整个国家去做一个创新。那我们甚至也有跟 Intel Inside 类似的一个想法，是说把阿里云计算的核心平台飞天这样的平台变成一个阿里云 Inside 的一个玩法，就是我们希望能够跟更多的合作伙伴在底层做创新，然后开放一个更大的生态，去跟更多的国内的合作伙伴、软件商去做合作，覆盖到 SaaS 啊，包括我们的开发者，包括我们的大学合作，当然还有我们在共建数据中心方面的一个合作。那么我觉得整个从阿里的文化、相信生态来看，跟 Intel 啊几十年来的技术的一个生态的玩法是如出一辙。我们也希望在下一个10年，在帮助中国建立一个全新的云生态啊。我们右边强调了是说未来技术是在下边是 enable 的，上边是很大的一个云的服务以及创新生态，最顶上我们希望能够对整个全社会的创新带来很大的一个帮助。这方面阿里还会跟 Intel 走得很远。好，谢谢。
Yeah, I do want to thank Alibaba for being the first worldwide to implement the Intel Rack Scale Architecture Reference Design and get it powered up and running. So we really appreciate the continued innovation from Alibaba. So an exciting ramification of the move to cloud computing is the convergence of communication technology with information technology. So today the telecommunications industry is under tremendous pressure. They're struggling to support the rapidly growing operational and capital expenses that are needed to keep up with the data traffic growth. And they're struggling to sufficiently monetize that infrastructure. They look over to their data center IT peers, and they're envious. The data center IT guys are getting higher and higher levels of utilization from their infrastructure through software-defined infrastructure. And are able to rapidly deploy new services for revenue through cloud computing. And so the solution is to move off of fixed function proprietary network gear and move on to virtualized network applications running on Intel servers. The benefits are threefold. First, you get all the benefits of the server volume economics. Second, you get the efficiency through virtualization technology. And third, you get the access to new cloud business models. There's tremendous momentum in the industry in this shift. The pace of adoption for the telco industry is staggering. If you go from very first lab results proving that Intel architecture could run network workloads, that was back in 2011, to an industry specification through ETSI in 2012, to the first commercial deployments of network function virtualization at the end of last year, 2014. So in 3 short years, the telco industry validated and adopted Intel architecture. The ETSI NFV community has grown to 185 member companies with Intel as a founding member. And we are now able to run all network workloads end-to-end on Intel architecture. And we have been building with you an ecosystem around Intel architecture for the network, with now over 150 members to that Network Builders program. So with IA, it's possible now to run the network workloads thanks to just the standard increase that we deliver of our Xeon product line, generation after generation, more cores per processor and higher performance per core thanks to Moore's Law, as well as very specific investments that we've made to accelerate network workloads, data packet acceleration, deep packet inspection, compression, and encryption. And although the telco industry is the one that has driven the formal specification around network function virtualization, the benefits apply equally to the data center side. There's a rapidly growing number of enterprises that are adopting virtualized network functions with the same CapEx and OpEx benefits. So you get a greater time to deploying new capacity into your network or to reconfiguring the existing network, going from what would traditionally take IT a month or more to now nearly instant. And we are very fortunate to have with us Huawei, who is clearly a global leader in information and communication technology solutions. They are continuously innovating to deliver greater value to telco carriers, to enterprise, and to consumers. And so I'd like to introduce Dr. Sanghee Li. He's the CTO of Huawei's product and solutions, and he's going to tell you about their vision for the network. Dr. Li?
Thank you for the invitation. Today we are living in a new digital world where every business becomes digital business and 100 billions of the new devices will be connected through the internet. So the telecom industry is also going through this major fundamental transformation characterized by software-defined network or the SubCom as Huawei envisioned. Now this diagram shows the network diagram. Such a transformation involves 3 domains. In the control network domain, SDN is to decouple the network control and management from the network hardware devices, such that the hardware devices become abstracted, programmable, so the network resource can be dynamically allocated, optimized to enrich the user experiences. In the data network data domain, the NFV is where the advanced network functions to be virtualized and become software modulated, such that it will be much easier to deploy, faster to deploy, test it, upgrade it, maintain and support in the network. And the third domain is about operation, where today 80% of operators' budget goes to operation and management in the consolidated data center, but it's highly fragmented, siloed, long process, complicated process to make any change. So by leveraging the cloud, big data, analytic technologies, okay, and then the next generation network operation will become much lean, fast, adaptive, agile through the automation and orchestration. In the fourth domain, which is about service enabling platform, which is about the telco bottom business line. How do you create the new value proposition in the new digital ecosystem? Interconnecting with smart city, green energy, industrial internet, video, online education, and so on. So today, Huawei has been actively engaged with worldwide leading carrier to embrace, to accelerate such a transformation across all these four domains. And we actually worked with Intel historically, partnered together in the internet, in telecom industries, where we are, Huawei was the first vendor adopted Intel processing technology into the network devices. And in recent years, we partnered further in the ICT infrastructures as the data center storage, computing, and networking devices. And according to Gartner's recent report, Huawei is ranked top three worldwide in x86 server shipment in last 6 quarters, and top three in China for the last 8 quarters. Now moving forward, as Diane talked about, the importance to build this software ecosystem foundation together for all these players together, because we can leverage so much in the open source ecosystem foundations to build a solution to ensure such a transformation for the operator to go towards the software-defined network. And these are some of these organizations in the open source community where Huawei and Intel jointly effectively contributing and build such an ecosystem foundation such that to ensure the success of the telco next big wave transformation, software defined network. We're looking forward to further collaborate, enhance our relationship to build together such ecosystem for the success of the telco industries. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you. So another area of tremendous growth is high performance computing, and it's evident in China. When you think HPC, you naturally think supercomputing, and supercomputers are actually a third of all HPC systems deployed. If you look at supercomputing, China's total flops on the supercomputing top 500 list has grown a staggering 900x over the past decade, with 3 times the number of systems, and of course, the number one system today running on Intel architecture. The applications, though, of HPC are moving rapidly beyond supercomputing as the recognition of the power of analytics is more broadly understood. So growing beyond academia and universities and government into broad commercial deployments. Big data is one of those applications. So there is a forecast that 60% of all big data analytics workloads by 2018 will require high performance computing infrastructure due to the complex analytics. We will also see more and more high performance computing solutions deployed through the cloud. It's forecasted that by 2018, 40% of all HPC capacity will come on demand through the cloud. And of course, we're very proud of the role that Intel has played in high performance computing. At this past November Supercomputing 2014 event, Intel powered systems were 97% of all new systems on the list. So that's 66 out of 68 systems were running on Intel. And we just publicly demonstrated the next generation of Xeon Phi, which is codenamed Knights Landing. Knights Landing has 8 billion transistors, so that's more than one transistor for everyone on the planet. And it is delivering 3x performance improvement over the prior generation. China is clearly a growing force in high-performance computing, and is high-performance computing is creating a significant opportunity for local innovation. However, the high-performance computing market, if it's to grow consistent with the actual demand, it's going to require an increased investment in software. So IDC actually predicts that software will be the biggest limiter for reaching exascale levels of computing. You'll need greater and greater levels of code scalability, obviously, and greater levels of resiliency built into the code. So we need the applications to be there to exploit the benefits of the modern hardware. We need to enable the next decade of discovery in solving the biggest challenges in society, in the industries, and in the sciences. And so we're doing that by working with universities and labs and institutes to enable the future. And I'm thrilled to announce today that we are opening our first Intel Parallel Computing Center here in China. It's in partnership with the Supercomputing Center of the China Academy of Sciences. So the SCCAS has been a China leader in supercomputing deployment, operations, and support since 1996. So we are thrilled to have them as a partner. The overarching objectives of the Intel Parallel Computing Centers are threefold. One is to modernize those community codes to run on highly parallel architectures. The second is to develop the curriculum to train the next generation of students, scientists, and researchers in parallel programming techniques. And the third is to build a broader community around HPC. So acceleration of the impact that technology can have on society requires very strong partnership. And Lenovo is a very strong partner to Intel. We appreciate the long and fruitful relationship between Intel and Lenovo and are excited about the investments that Lenovo has made and is continuing to make to be a worldwide leader in information technology. So I'd like to welcome Mr. Wenping Gao to stage. He's VP of Lenovo's Enterprise China Group. Mr. Gao?
各位早上好，正如大家刚才讲的，应用和技术的高速发展呢，让HPC变得前所未有的关键。事实上呢，HPC成为我们大家谈论最多的大数据、云计算的一个最基本、最核心的解决方案。也正是基于这样的考量，联想未来的技术路线之一就是通过不断的提供HPC平台技术和解决方案，来帮助客户迎合未来时代的挑战。尤其是我们完成了 IBM 服务器业务的整合以后，我们可以调动全球的人才资源、专利技术和产品，来更好地为中国的客户服务。那再往下讲，具体到产品，我们将顺着两个方向去不断丰富我们的产品线。第一个，高性能，顾名思义，那就是不断地去追求 performance 更快更高。 比如说，我们launch了我们的这个高密度机柜服务器，它用最新的刀片技术和水冷技术，再结合刚才大家讲的 Intel 的 Netlining 的 process， 在一个机柜服务器就能实现千万亿次的这样的计算能力，这在以前是不敢想象的。第二个考量的方向就是从客户的这个 concern 这个角度去解决问题，客户其实还关心。 它的应用软件实际的运行效率太低，要解决这个问题呢的一个方向，那就是要针对应用开发定制化的加速系统。而谈到这个加速技术，不得不提这个 FPGA 这个重构技术，现在很多人都了解。它的原理就是把应用软件的核心算法固化在硬件当中，通过硬件来实现。 这样不但能够提高这个应用软件的运行效率，更主要的一点是它能够增加整个硬件系统的柔性。有了这样的一个平台基础，能够更好的实现大家讲的软件定义一切这样一个概念。当然，实现这些还是不够的。大家知道一些新的应用兴起，我们耳熟能详的大数据、物联网，最近还比较热的一个词是 deep learning， 这个深度学习。 而且这些新的应用呢，都对计算模型和存储的模式呢有新的要求，这就需要我们建立更强大的计算平台，来支持不光是以前的高性能计算、并行计算，还要支持这个流计算、图计算，对吧？存储模式呢要支持更多的图形模式啊，这个并行文件系统、分布式文件系统、分布式数据库等等。当然更理想的是，如果这样一个平台能够通过软件定义来灵活的调配资源，那就更理想了。当然要实现这一个目标呢，就需要业界的这个合作。所以呢，这个在这里呢，我想也借这个机会呢公布一个消息，那联想呢跟Intel将合作在中国建中国的企业级产品和技术的创新中心。事实上呢，我们三月份已经在欧洲德国的斯图尔特呢，这建成了欧洲的创新中心。那这是第二家，建在北京。它将来呢是一个产品技术的孵化器，同时也是一个交流平台。我们想利用这个平台形成一个联盟，来协同业界领先的技术公司的能力，共同努力，来为中国的客户呢提供最好的 HPC 服务。所以简单地和大家分享这些，谢谢各位。
Collaborations with Lenovo. Thank you. So the third significant growth driver of the data center is big data. So big data is the next big technology disruptor. It has the ability to transform all industries. And there's many examples of those transformations happening already here in China. Look at the banking industry. So the Agricultural Bank of China, using Cloudera's Hadoop, they created an enterprise data hub. The bank is able to provide near real-time query of any account or any financial history, historical activity, all of it running on the latest Intel Xeon E5 processors. The transportation industry is another great one. So BoCom has delivered a real-time traffic analysis system, providing a range of services and solutions from identification of fake vehicle licenses to forecasting traffic trends. And through collaboration between Alcatel-Lucent, equipment manufacturer, and Cloudera, they've created here in China a means for the mobile carriers to utilize the massive amounts of data for improved services to the consumer, as well as creating promotional packages to drive up their revenue, all, of course, running on the Intel Xeon E5 servers. We have a very close partnership with Cloudera to ensure that Cloudera's distribution of Hadoop is tuned and takes full advantage of all of the Intel capabilities. And the success that we're having as a partnership is reflected in some of the nice awards we've received from China. So another industry, though, that will tremendously benefit from big data is the health industry. It's an industry with massive amounts of data, from clinical data, diagnostic data, genomics data, personal data. It's also an industry that has been relatively slow to adopt technology worldwide. Through the use of big data solutions, precision or personalized medicine becomes a possibility. The field of genomics is at an inflection point. If you look in 2001, a full genome sequence cost over $100 million. Now, it's less than $1,000, thanks to the continued investment in technology efficiency. That's allowed genomics to move from the research world now into the commercial world. Through genome sequencing and then the analysis of those sequences that follow, a treatment is able now to be created that is custom to the patient. And one area that you can apply this insight into treatment is in cancer. So by applying the latest in cloud computing, high performance computing, and big data analytics, and by working together as an industry, we can enable the sequencing of a whole genome, identify the fundamental genes that cause the cancer, and then identify the means to block those genes through the creation of personalized treatment. And we can do it all in one day by 2020. And given the number of people that are impacted by cancer, we don't want to waste any time. Half of all men and a third of all women worldwide will get cancer in their lifetime. The impact cancer is having here in China is even greater. So China makes up 20% of the world's population, but it's 22% of the world's new cancer cases and 27% of the world's cancer deaths. So the stakes are very high, and the potential for great impact through the application of technology is huge. And so to conclude, the future of the data center is software defined. Through our partnership with the China technology leaders, we will collectively enable the digital service economy, and we will deliver the next decade of discovery. Discovery in solving the biggest challenges in society, in industry, and in the sciences. Thank you.